So let's go over to this graph here on the right and zoom in on it and compare enzyme induction, what we did in the last video, to competitive inhibition. So if we're decreasing the rate of drug metabolism, here on the y-axis I have the rate of drug metabolism, and on the x-axis I have the plasma concentration of a certain drug. And so I'm going to draw this graph in the presence of a competitive inhibitor. So if there's a competitive inhibitor present, what happens is that the rate of drug metabolism is going to be lower. And it's going to be lower at most dosages, up to a certain point. And at this certain point, once the plasma concentration of the drug being metabolized, that primary drug, once that really goes up, these kind of equal out. So the orange is the control, the purple is that same drug in the presence of a competitive inhibitor. But the main point to notice is that at most of these plasma concentrations, the rate of drug metabolism has decreased. And there are two consequences of that. So let's write competitive inhibitors. And let's see what the two consequences are. So with enzyme inducers, we saw, if I'm increasing the rate of metabolism, I'm going to make more metabolites. With competitive inhibitors, it's exactly the opposite. I'm decreasing metabolism, so therefore I'm going to make less metabolites. Decreased number of metabolites. Now this can be a good thing or a bad thing. Let's talk about how it's a good thing. Imagine these metabolites were toxic. If I gave a competitive inhibitor, that might decrease the number of those toxic metabolites, and thus the competitive inhibitor could be therapeutic. On the flip side though, if we're making less metabolites, what is going up? The drug concentration. I'm not metabolizing, the drug is building up. So I can get an increase in drug concentration as well. Drug concentration. And therefore, if that drug has side effects, I might see those side effects. And so this is an important example with a class of drug called the statins. For here, decreased number of metabolites, that's going to be our next example that we'll do. So let's go back to our main page here. So the example that I like the most with competitive inhibitors is antifreeze poisoning and treating that poisoning with alcohol. And I wrote acute here to differentiate it from before when we talked about chronic alcohol use, which was actually an enzyme inducer. So antifreeze. Well, first, what is that component in antifreeze which is so toxic? That is called ethylene glycol. Ethylene glycol. That is what antifreeze is. And so ethylene glycol, or that main component in antifreeze, undergoes a two-step metabolic process and eventually forms something called oxalic acid. And oxalic acid is problematic because it causes renal problems. And patients typically get, when they overdose without any sort of treatment, acute renal failure. Let's just say renal failure. That's what oxalic acid can lead to. And so the reason we can use acute alcohol to treat ethylene glycol poisoning is because they both compete for that same enzyme. And that enzyme is called alcohol dehydrogenase, ADH. So let's draw that right here, ADH. And so what acute alcohol use is doing, or giving a bolus of alcohol, if I give ETOH, what's going to happen is it's going to inhibit that alcohol dehydrogenase, and therefore the levels of oxalic acid won't be created as quickly. We're less likely to get renal failure, and and we might even be able to find other ways to get rid of that, to get rid of these metabolites. And so I'd like to represent all of this with kind of a picture. And so here is our enzyme. This is alcohol dehydrogenase, and let me use the correct color here. That's this guy right here. So here's our enzyme, and it's munching away at the, you know, the endogenous substrate. This is the antifreeze. So I'll write here, this is the ethylene glycol. So the point is that in order to avoid this enzyme metabolizing the ethylene glycol, we're trying to distract it by throwing another substrate at it. And that other substrate is alcohol. And so what I'm going to do is just, you know, give an IV dose of alcohol and hope that by giving more alcohol there, it is kind of distracting it, the enzyme, from the ethylene glycol so that it can't metabolize it. And we have pathways for alcohol that are easier to get rid of. Now, I should note that as of recently, you know, alcohol has kind of fallen out of favor. And so this could be ETOH. But most recently, they use a new drug called Fomepizole. Fomepizole. And this is probably what most toxicologists would recommend in the emergency department. But if you don't have the Fomepizole available, you could just as easily use, you know, IV alcohol, or, you know, you could even be a little creative and use whiskey or something. Now, obviously I'm not giving you, you know, don't take this as medical advice, but it is a old treatment for ethylene glycol poisoning. And so that's the gist of competitive inhibitors. So in the next video, we're going to look specifically at statins. And statins are probably responsible for some of the most common drug interactions in relation to competitive inhibition.